Discussing the diagnosis and surgical management of lower GI, Dr. Pillai already talked about diagnosis. I'll share only a few points, but mainly it will be a surgical management. I welcome all the audience to be here on a busy afternoon. You must have finished all your OPDs right now, and some people are also doing online OPDs. So we'll be starting the topic. Slide. What are the causes of lower GI bleeding? Already, sir, Dr. Priyesh has discussed all these things. So we'll discuss the further aspects about it. Lower GI bleeding is usually classified as bleeding below the second part of duodenum. Anything above the second part of duodenum is classified as upper GI bleeding. Now this distinction is very important, because upper GI bleeding will always be, most of the time will be malina, black tarry stools, because the acid gets mixed with the blood and therefore it will get us black tarry stools. But below the level of papilla or ampulla or in the second part of duodenum, all the bleed will be classified lower GI bleed, and they will mostly be hematochezia, fresh blood coming for rectum. If the bleed is in the upper GI tract and it is massive in amount, still you can get lower GI bleed coming from the stomach also. So this distinction, normally that second part of duodenum is the line where we classify it as hematemesis versus malina. So this is basic. And what are the causes of lower GI bleed? Sir has shown you diverticulitis, diverticulosis, or colonic diverticuli, which don't bleed necessarily, but if they get diverticulitis, inflamed, then they may bleed, and that can be a small bleed, that can be a major bleed also causing hypotension. Other common things in general practice are colitis. It can be infective colitis. It can be ischemic colitis, as we are seeing nowadays in COVID. In COVID times, we are seeing some ischemic colitis also. The blood vessels are getting blocked. And infection. Infections means acute gastroenteritis, acute colitis caused because of bacterial or viral infection. Of course, a viral infection can also cause colitis and can give rise to lower GI bleeds. Amebiasis. So commonly seen, these are the commonly seen things in all these in GP practice, general practitioners, OPDs. Vascular anomalies like angiodysplasias of the colon, rectum. Neoplasia is the second commonest after the infective things. Neoplasia means malignancy, colorectal cancers. Cancers arising from the small bowel, colon, from the duodenum distal part, from the rectum, from the anal verge, can also present as lower GI bleed. And of course, hemorrhoids, piles, fissure, sometimes fistula can give rise to small amount of lower GI bleed. How do you distinguish between piles, fissure bleed versus upper colonic bleeds is that piles, fissure blood will usually be at the start of the passing motion, or after you have passed the motion, they will normally not be mixed with the stools. But colonic bleeds will be mixed with the stools. This is a differentiating factor. If the blood is mixed with the stool, they are normally coming from above. If they are not mixed, they are separately falling in the commode, then they are piles, fissure, or rarely fistula bleeds. These are the common causes. So in my practice, I would first rule out infective etiology. Second will be I'll rule out piles, fissure. Always do a per-rectal examination in any bleed from the anus to see whether it's a local cause or it's a proximal cause. And lastly, but not least, we are seeing a lot of colorectal cancers which are presenting as GI bleed. Colorectal plus small bowel, intestinal cancers also can present as lower GI bleed. What are the core principles in GI bleed management? First thing is to stabilize the patient. Check his vitals, check his pulse, check his BP, whether he can be treated on an OPD basis or he needs hospitalization. If there is tachycardia, pulse is more than 100, blood pressure is falling, blood pressure is low, blood pressure systolic is less than 100, if there is tachypnea, if their peripherals are cold and clammy, always admit the patient, because there can be a patient can complain that I had a small bleed, but it can be a massive bleed later after an hour or so. So always admit the patient if there are signs of hypotension. Determine the source of bleed. Always do a per-rectal examination, see whether piles fissure is bleeding. If not, again, admit the patient. If you are not seeing piles or fissure bleeding, admit the patient. Safest is to admit the patient. Of course, the patient comes, walks in the OPD, small quantity of bleed, history of piles, you need not admit the patient. So do a per-rectal examination. And if possible, proctoscopy is there available. Do a proctoscopy, immediately come to know whether blood is coming from the colon or blood is from the local area. If the blood is from local area, there will be associated pain. It will be painful bleed. If the blood is coming from the colon, it may not be painful. So that is other distinguishing factor. Treat the underlying abnormality, prevent recurrent bleed. The patient has walked to your OPD and says, I am having recurrent bleeding. So always investigate the patient properly. If there is no pile fissure, always advise a colonoscopy. Don't hesitate in advising a colonoscopy, because piles may be there and you feel the blood is coming from the piles, it may not be so. If the piles are actively bleeding, we'll pick it up on a PR examination as well. But if the blood is coming from above, you'll miss it. A lot of people may be having cancers in the colon and they are being treated as hemorrhoids. And after 3-4 settings of treatment, they are coming back as colorectal cancers. But till that time, you have missed the chance. Colonoscopy is the mainstay of diagnosis. Even Dr. Priyesh will agree. Colonoscopy is the mainstay of diagnosis after your proctoscopy is normal. If your proctoscopy is normal, please advise the patient to undergo some form of diagnostic model. CBC is the basic test. Do a stool test. Look for active blood cells, RBCs in the stool examination. Do a colonoscopy if necessary and get a basic ultrasound done. Ultrasound can pick up rectal tumors, colorectal malignancies, ascites, peritoneal seedlings. If possible, there are big, large peritoneal seedlings. It may be picked up on basic sonography as well. So sonography, hemogram and colonoscopy are the main important things which you should always look for in your diagnostic armamentarium. So these are the colonic diverticuli. Dr. Priyesh has shared this photo. So these are the colonic diverticuli. They are outpouchings. They are herniations from the wall of the colon. This is because Indians have a diet which gives a lot of constipation. They don't have a lot of fiber, and that can give rise to outpouchings because of pressure below at the anal canal. So, You can have this bleed. See, you can see the blood is coming from the diverticuli. That means the diverticuli has got infected and is bleeding freely now. So this can present as hematogenia. It can be mild bleed, but it can be a massive bleed causing hypotension as well. If you notice, if you do the proctoscopy, you will find there is no pus, no fissure. But you will still feel your finger is catching blood, the glove is catching blood, and you are seeing some clots in the... If there are clots in the anal canal, obviously the bleeding is coming from above. So don't miss... Immediately admit the patient and do a colonoscopy. Radiation proctitis is the other cause. A lot of patients have CA, uterus, cervix, malignancies in the pelvis. They undergo radiation for that. And so what radiation does, it obviously burns the malignant cells, but it can also burn the normal cells and give rise to such radiation changes in the rectum. So if you radiate the pelvis, you will always get some changes in the rectum, because rectum is a fixed organ. It is not mobile. Small bowel will not be having these changes, but rectum will definitely have this. Proctitis means rectum has got these radiation changes. They can bleed sometimes. Treatment is giving sucrophil enemas. You can stop the radiation for some time, let this heal, and then go again for radiation. Your medical oncologist will guide you for that. But radiation proctitis can sometimes be troublesome. Sucrophil enemas are a better... Pause injections, you can use tranexamic acid. But as soon as you stop radiation, the effect of radiation goes, these changes will revert back to normal. So radiation proctitis can give rise to lower GI bleed. I'm not discussing the things which already been discussed by Dr. Priyesh Patel. I'm just focusing on some rare other bleeding AV malformation, arteriovenous malformation. Again, a very rare thing. Very rare, but not very rare in elderly people, in diabetics, in patients who are undergoing dialysis. They get this AV malformation. I just now saw a patient a few days back who is recurrently bleeding from the rectum. Nothing is getting picked. This is the angio of this lady, which is showing colonic. If you can see this is the angiography which has been done from the femoral root. You can see there is a blush of blood here. This is the AV malformation. It must be in the hepatic flexure of the colon. So she was bleeding from the hepatic flexure of colon. You can see a extravasation of the angio dye coming out. This is a AV malformation. They will present a GI bleed, anemia, and only treatment is to either coil the vessel by putting embolization coils in this, or you have to resect that area sometimes. So bleeding AV malformation, very rare but not uncommon. It is seen in elderly people. Ulcerative colitis. Sir showed you some pictures of ulcerative colitis where you see a lot of ulcers in the whole colon. The whole colon is studded with ulcers. It's very, it's not a common condition, but not very rare also. So I see roughly one or two patients in a month who come with bleeding per rectum. Colonoscopy done shows deep ulcers in the colon. Ulcerative colitis is a disease of the whole colon. Sometimes it may be restricted to the rectum, but if it is an advanced stage, it can involve the whole colon. So what are those complications of ulcerative colitis which bleed? Is acute colitis. Acute colitis is it's a severe form of colitis where the patient keeps bleeding. Patient is on azoram, patient is on steroids, patient on all forms of treatment for ulcerative colitis, but bleeding is not stopping. They can go into toxic megacolon where there is paralysis of the colon and they become large megacolons. They can perforate, they can bleed. So this will be the picture of a toxic megacolon. If we see, this is a rectum, this is the colon. You can see the whole colon is dilated. You can especially see this part. This portion has lost its haustations. You can see the haustations here, but here in this part, the haustations are lost. So this is a toxic megacolon. It is on the verge of perforation. If it perforates, you have to do emergency surgery. So this is one more cause of a lower GI bleeding. Now treatment depends on what you find. If it is a hemorrhoids, if it is a fissure, if it is a piles, you will treat the piles or fissure or the fistula. If it is a malignancy, you have to go for surgery, which can be laparoscopic or open surgery. I'll tell you in few further slides what is the laparoscopic surgery advantages. But all the things, all the cancers, all the tumors, all tuberculosis, rarely tuberculosis of the IC junction can present like this. Treatment is surgical resection, which can be very well be done laparoscopically where you have small scars. So I will not discuss treatment of piles, treatment of fissure pile. I'll discuss one topic because it is a massive topic. Lower GI is a massive topic. So best is to recognize it fast, admit the patient, do a hemogram, do sonography, do colonoscopy and treat the cause. Resuscitate the patient completely before you post the patient for colonoscopy. The bowel preparation is required for colonoscopy, which sir has already discussed. Let it be at least a daycare procedure. Don't do the patient and send the patient home. At least admit for 3-4 hours because it requires some form of sedation or anesthesia during colonoscopy. It's very painful procedure. Once the patient comes out of anesthesia, let the patient have some water, juice, and then the patient can go home. And once the patient is completely out of anesthesia, don't hesitate in asking for a colonoscopy because colonoscopy is the mainstay of diagnosis. If you miss it, CT scan can miss it, your sonography can miss it, but colonoscopy, if colonoscopy is normal, you can be rest assured that the bleeding, at least from not from the colon, then you have to investigate for a small bowel bleed. If your colonoscopy is normal and if the blood is still coming and your hemoglobin is falling, you have to investigate for a small bowel bleed. There is no scope which can enter. Of course, the colonoscope can enter a distal five, maybe a half a foot of a distal ileum, but the whole jejunum ileum cannot be seen by a ogidoscopy or a colonoscopy. There are some other methods called capsule endoscopy, where the capsule has a camera. You have to swallow the pill. It goes through whole of your intestine. Then you see the recordings on the screen, and you will find that there are some polyps or some tumors or some maybe tuberculosis or Crohn's of the small bowel, which is giving rise to these bleeds. So capsule endoscopy is one thing, which is very costly, but it will give you diagnosis. If your endoscopy above ogidoscopy and colonoscopy is normal, you can find the source of the bleed in a capsule endoscopy. The only condition for capsule endoscopy, there should be no obstruction of the bowel because the capsule will get stuck there and you have to do a surgery to remove that capsule. So a prior CT scan of the abdomen is necessary that there is no obstructive pathology in the small bowel, and then you can go for a capsule endoscopy. So these are the basic parameters how to assess it. Surgically, treatment is either angiographic embolization for an AV malformation, treatment of a piles, laser or stapler, treatment of a fissure. If you have noted all these things, I'll discuss only one condition today for lack of time, is ulcerative colitis, which is seen in your normal practice, but difficult to diagnose. Colonoscopy is a test of It is the most important test to diagnose ulcerative colitis. A lot of people can be passed off as infective colitis on oflox onidazole tablets, but these very patients may be ulcerative colitis and not infective colitis. So if the patient is requiring lot of antibiotics, lot of hematinics, and you're not getting a diagnosis, please do a colonoscopy. Ask the gastroenterologist to take multiple biopsies from multiple areas, from the cecum, from the ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, and from the rectum, you'll find, and send the specimen to a good histopathologist. They will pick up. There are classical features of ulcerative colitis on slides, which is crypt granulomas, crypt abscesses, which are very classical to ulcerative colitis, which cannot be missed by any pathologist. So send your biopsy specimen to the right person and you'll get the right answer. Treatment of ulcerative colitis is medical, medical, and medical only, except few rare cases I mentioned just before. These are the indications for a surgery. 90% of patients will 90% of patients will not require surgery. 10% only will require surgery. These are the patients who have been on life long term, say 3-4-5 years of medical management. They are not responding, they are bleeding in spite of giving steroids, IV steroids, repeated admissions. There are a lot of other molecules, azathioprine, steroids, mesalamines. They have been on this treatment for a long time and they have started losing weight now and they are not improving. Then only we go for surgery. Only 10% of, maybe 10 is also a higher number. 3 to 4% of people will require surgery. So what are the indications of surgery in ulcerative colitis? It's intractability, I told you, debilitating symptoms. The patient is getting complications of a steroid therapy. There are extracolonic manifestations of ulcerative colitis, like some people will get uveitis in the eye, some people will get joint pains, rheumatoid arthritis, some people will get jaundice, they get the biliary manifestations, because these are all autoimmune diseases. Your cells are misbehaving and therefore they are forming antibodies against their own cells. This is what is autoimmune disease means. Ulcerative colitis is an autoimmune disease where your cells are misbehaving and they are forming antibodies against your own cells. And therefore, they can lead to all these lower GI bleeds. There's sometimes, very rare, they can cause dysplasias, common, not common, but they can turn into carcinomas. So ulcerative colitis, long-standing ulcerative colitis, taking treatment for 20 years, maybe they will, at the 20th or 25th year, they will develop a malignancy. Massive colonic bleed. They can have a massive colonic blood bleeding. It is an uncommon event. Only 5% or maybe less than 5% of patients will require surgery for a massive GI bleed. Toxic megaclone, I told you, IV fluids. You have to admit these patients, give them broad spectrum antibiotics. But if there is deterioration or there is lack of improvement in a toxic megaclone, you don't wait it for it to perforate, then you have to go for a surgery. I'll tell you what surgery needs to be done. There are a lot of operations which are earlier, from 1980s, the operations have come in place. Segmental colectomies was first. Suppose the patient had rectal bleeding only, proctitis, ulcerative proctitis. The concept was to do a segmental colectomy. But what they found after doing that, they started getting recurrence in the other parts. Ulcerative colitis, the name itself says it's a disease of the whole colon. So even if you have ulcerative proctitis and you are needing surgery for massive bleeding, not to do a segmental colectomy, you have to do a total abdominal colectomy. That is ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, and you should also include a rectum. I'll come why. Because if you don't do this, you will get colitis in the remnant segment. So next operation which was proposed was abdominal colectomy with an ileorectal anastomosis. You spare the rectum. But problem was, you need to have a good surveillance. These patients usually come from rural areas where there are not much facilities for doing every 6 months colonoscopies. So what used to happen, that they used to be neglected, and after 5 years they used to come with the ulcerative proctitis. So abdominal colectomy with ileorectal anastomosis is now sparingly used. Instead, we have other options where we do total proctocolectomy. What do you mean by total proctocolectomy? I'll show you. This is a total proctocolectomy. If you appreciate this figure, there is an appendix, there is a cecum, there is an ascending colon, there is a transverse colon, descending colon, and rectum. So this is total proctocolectomy. I'll go back to my slide. There are two options after doing a total proctocolectomy. Either you get the end ileostomy out and just staple the anal canal down. So this patient will have permanent stroma outside for life. Normally these patients are young patients. So to keep, don't, not to give them a natural way of evacuation through the anus is not good. If the patient is old, say 70 years of age, normally these they usually present in adolescent age. But suppose your patient is old, then you can safely use this total proctal colectomy and dilatation option. But for a young patient, you have to recreate his natural pathway. So what we do, we create a pouch. We do a total proctal colectomy with ileal pouch anal anastomosis. I'll show you this. So we create such, if we join the ileum directly to the anal canal, what will be, colon is a reservoir. If you know, colon is a reservoir. So till the stools come from, till your food comes from the mouth to the IC junction, the stools are liquid. But as soon as they start traversing the colon, the water starts getting absorbed. Colon has only one function, is to absorb the water. So if you ask me what will happen, doctor, if the colectomy is done, how will the patient function? Colon's job is just to absorb water. There is no role of colon in digestion and in digestive process. So if we remove the colon and if you join ileum, as is seen here, directly to the anal canal, what will happen? The patient will pass 20 to 24 stools in a day. Because this ileum will not have any absorptive function, or storage function will not be there because we also remove the rectum. So what we do, we take two loops of ileum and join them by a stapler. You can see this, and create an artificial reservoir of the rectum, like a rectum of the ileum. This is one loop of ileum, these are two loops which are joined together, and then joined to the anal canal. This is called an ileo-anal J pouch. Now this will store your stools till you get satisfactory place where you can go and evacuate. And this person will have four stools in a day, not 24 stools in a day, but four stools in a day. Now you still will ask me, four stools in a day, isn't it cumbersome for office going person? My answer is, the ulcerative colitis patients are so terribly, what are the main symptoms of ulcerative colitis? Lot of stools in a day, 10 to 12 stools in a day, loose motions, mucus in stools and blood in stools. So for this patient who was passing normally 12 to 15 stools in a day with blood, mucus and pain, now he will pass only 4 stools in a day. So that patient, if you ask him what is better, they will always say this is better. So 4 stools in a day, good quantity, good quality, soft to semi-hard stools, 4 times in a day. Continent means to say, when you get a washroom, you can go and pass a stool. Otherwise, if we join this, we will be in a lot of hurry to pass stools and you may end up having incontinence. So therefore, pouch surgery, I'll come back to my original slide. Here, total proctal colectomy with ileal pouch anal anastomosis, the modality of treatment now for ulcerative colitis patients. I'll not go into the detailed slides, but what is the advantage of removing the whole colon and rectum is it removes all the disease mucosa, prevents cancers of the remnant segment if we leave them. Only problem is some morbidities are there, adhesions, complications of the pouch and all those things. Elderly people, we cannot do the pouch. But if you ask what is the best treatment, this is the best treatment for ulcerative colitis patients only if they are not responding to medical line of treatment. It was devised by Devin. It preserves sphincter function. All these patients will have good sphincter tone, they will be able to hold their stools. It is not that they will be incontinent. They will always be able to hold their stools. So it will be a good functional pouch. So patient satisfaction was studied from a Mayo Clinic. Mayo Clinic is in the US. What they studied, as compared to ileal anastomosis, the patients of pouch were always very happy. But IRA patients, ileorectal anastomosis patients, always required surveillance. These patients of pouch will not require surveillance, no further colonoscopies, because you have removed the rectum and the colon both. Contraindications to ileorectal anastomosis, I told you, we cannot retain the rectum because it can cause cancers. So this is the operation of choice. I told you a single chambered pouch is fashioned from the distal 30 centimeter of the ileum, 15 centimeter one limb, 15 centimeter one limb. They are both are joined to make a 30 centimeter pouch. Capacity of the pouch is 15 into 15 to 25 ml is the capacity of the pouch. So what? When the pouch distance to 225 to 250 ml of stools, then you can pass. In normal person, the capacity of the rectum is 300 to 400 ml. It means when your rectum is filled to that volume, then you get the urge and then you search for a washroom and go and pass your stools. So we are creating a 250, 225 to 250 centimeter cc's volume of a pouch, and it's sutured to the anus using a double staple technique, where it's a lock and key circular staple which joins directly the anus to the pouch. Now this is possible because of modern technology. We get a stapler, we can directly join it. We cannot go and suture the pouch to the anus. It's very difficult. So this is the operation done by us at Curie Hospital, where we remove the appendix, colon, cecum, rectum, up to the rectum. We have stapled it down and we have joined the ileal pouch to the anus. This whole surgery of removing this whole thing has been done laparoscopically. This is the abdomen of the patient, this patient only. This is the head end, this is the navel, this is the tail end or the pelvis. We have to give a divergent ileostomy. From this incision, we got this whole specimen out. Whole specimen has come out from this incision. And then we have given a divergent ileostomy to the patient. Whole surgery of this massive surgery of removing the whole colon has been done by laparoscopic. And we have given just a small incision to take out the stoma and the specimen. So laparoscopy has a lot of advantages because these patients are young. If you try to do open surgery, they'll get a lot of adhesive obstructions later and can damage the pouch also. So minimal scars, massive surgery for such a big operation, especially in a young patient, gives a lot of benefit to the patient. These are the few techniques, but I don't want to go into that. These are the types of, there are normally what we use a J pouch, where we join two limbs. There can be S pouch, there can be W pouch, where we take two or three more limbs of the ileum. But these pouches, we found S and W pouches are very cumbersome to use for the patient. They used to have a lot of constipation. They used to require enemas to take out stools from these pouches. So we have stuck to best pouch, which is a J pouch, where immediately the stools will come very easily and you will not have any issue in delivering the stools out. This is simple how J pouch is created. And this is the anus where we join it with the lock and key staplers. Advantage of a laparoscopic surgery for a colorectal cancer or ulcerative colitis. These are the surgeries can be done, hemicolectomies, rectopexies. Advantages are that they are small wounds, less pain, faster recovery. Port site recurrence, there was a concern that open surgery is better. There are port site recurrences. We have found that there are no higher incidence of port site recurrence after laparoscopic surgery for cancer. Oncological margins are good. Cost is equal, I would say, or less in laparoscopic surgery because the stay of the patient is 3 to 4 days as compared to 7 to 8 days stay of open surgery. Learning curve is there. Yeah, it's a longer operation, but actually it's a faster surgery because you don't open the abdomen, you don't close the abdomen. So half an hour to 45 minutes are saved. Learning curve is there. Of course, an expert has to do this. Long-term outcome data is coming. We are waiting for that. Open surgery related immunosuppression people say laparoscopy has a better immune response because open surgery causes immunosuppression of the patient and patients recover slower. Port site recurrence are equal in both of them, no difference. These are evidence for laparoscopic approach to colorectal cancer. Laparoscopic approach is safe. Cost study trial done in America 2002. Shorter hospital stay, safer, reduced post-op painkillers or reduced post-op analgesic requirements. Conversion rates are not bad. All the procedures are now getting done laparoscopically only. My 90% colorectal surgery work is laparoscopic, only 10% is open surgery. Less morbidity, shorter hospital stay, lower rate of tumor recurrence, improved cancer survival found. There is a lot of myth that open surgery is better than laparoscopic surgery in cancer. It's a myth. It's not true. Other effects of positive effects of laparoscopic surgery are pulmonary functions are maintained better, less acute phase stress response, inflammatory response is dampened, quicker GI recovery, we are not touching the intestines, decreased adhesions, decrease in wound complications like wound hernias, incision hernias, we are not seeing now because of laparoscopic surgery. 90% of gallbladder and appendix surgeries are done by laparoscopy and therefore we are not seeing wound infections, incision hernias, morbidity is much, much less. Benefits to a surgeon, yes, of course there are some benefits to a surgeon. It is safer because you see 3 times magnified view, better visualization, improved dissection. Reduced blood loss using harmonic scalpel, we have it. Potential benefits for training because a lot of people can see the operation if it is laparoscopically done. We can show the videos to our trainees and they can learn the operation. Potential to improve quality, reduce post-operative pain, reduce hospital stay, improved cosmesis. I showed you the picture, such a major surgery. I can go back to that. Again, appreciate this picture. This is a laparoscopic surgery advantages. No big cut. Decrease in wound complication, quicker J. Patient will go on feeding on second post-operative day in a laparoscopic surgery and go home in fourth day, even after such a major surgery. Benefits to the patient, less scar, both internal and external, less pain, shorter hospital stay, quicker return to activities, cost is actually less because your hospital stay is less. Massive surgery, minimal scars. Thank you. Any questions to the audience? I'll be happy to take these questions. I know it was a surgical lecture. Everybody can open their, they can unmute themselves and ask questions to me and Dr. Priyesh Patel as well. Dr. Priyesh Patel, are you there? You can unmute yourself. You can unmute yourself. Yeah. Any comments on the surgical aspects, or if you have, I'm welcome to that. Dr. Patel, Dr. Priyesh Patel, any comments on surgical things? I'm welcome.
Okay, I actually have a comment. Yes, actually, there is excellent work with the laparoscopic total proctoglottectomy. So the only thing is, as you mentioned, the time after, as a trained individual, now that you have been doing it for quite some time, what was the time duration when you started was to the operation surgery hours, and what is the time duration now?
I started doing the laparoscopy for all these advanced surgeries from 2010, now we are in 2020. Earlier, I used to take 4 hours for doing a laparoscopic small colectomy and 6 hours for a major colectomy. Now, my time limit for both of them is 3 hours maximum. So, 50.
You were out in the jiffy. I know you were absolutely with clean cut procedures and very, very good outcome. I'm sure about that. That's true.
There has to be a team. It's a teamwork. There, my cameraman should be good. My OT staff should be trained. My OT technician should be trained. There's a lot of troubleshooting in laparoscopy. In open surgery, only one person should be trained. That is enough. That is a surgeon. But in laparoscopy, the whole team needs to be trained. You should have to have the advanced setup. You have to have a good ventilator. My ICU team is important. My ICU doctor is important. My anesthetist is important. They should give me bloodless feed. So every member of the team is very important in laparoscopy, because laparoscopy, the blood loss can be, I mean to say, 1 ml blood loss will be seen as 10 ml blood loss, because it is per feed. It is magnified view. So you'll start controlling the blood loss, which is actually not significant. So your BP should be low. The anesthetist is very important. Post-operative ICU care is fantastic at both the QA setups. So I hardly find any difference in outcomes as compared to QA with any other hospital which I operate elsewhere, which are bigger hospitals, maybe in volume, but work-wise, I find it very
complete. I have seen it by my own eyes. Definitely, the outcomes have been great, and the response rate has been phenomenal for sure. Absolutely, there's no doubt about it.
And not every patient go for surgery. 90% of these patients of lower GI bleed will be treated by medical management. Only 5 to 6% or 10% maximum will go for surgery. So this is a take-home message that not surgery is not the final answer to everything. Of course, colorectal cancer surgery is the best treatment, and then chemo radiation. But for benign diseases, we should try all the non-invasive methods of treatment. I can see Dr. Ajay.
You have already covered that a good history about localizing where exactly would be the cause of the bleeding, the melena versus hematochezia. Endoscopic evaluation to find out the source of bleeding first, and then the next possible steps would be making it a faster approach to the treatment and a long-term treatment, rather than labeling everybody as probably hemorrhoids and piles, which you might have been seen and kind of thing likewise, and then keeping on changing the doctors and finally finding a diagnosis much later, once we can do it much, 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 much earlier by simple evaluation by endoscopic means for sure.
So all anal swellings like piles are not necessarily the cause of bleeding. There can be a big cancer sitting in the colon and the small bowel, which if we miss but not doing the scopy or further investigate a patient, this patient may land out in stage 4 disease. So we don't want that to happen. So one test more is always better than one test less. That's what I feel. Because of course there is some clinical acumen, we have clinical knowledge, but see, if we miss something, it can be detrimental for the patient. I have no harm in saying that I always do a sonography, basic sonography in every patient of mine, because I am a tertiary place where the patient has come from. due to me. So I have to give justice to the patient that I will over investigate if required. I'll do one sonography more if required. I'll do one colonoscopy more if required. But I know that one patient and miss maybe nine other patients who may have gone for colonoscopy. Of course, colonoscopy has some mild side effects, but in the expert's hand, it is a safe test. Don't fear colonoscopy. It's a very safe test. It can give, even if it picks up one pathology or one malignancy in 10 patients which you have sent for colonoscopy, that one patient can be saved by that colonoscopy. You can pick up the lesion early, treat the lesion early. That patient can survive for 5 to 10 years more. And vice versa, if you have not done the colonoscopy and if you miss a malignancy, patient comes in stage 4 disease, you have decreased the survival rate of the patient from 10 years to straight away to 1 or 2 years. Whatever chemotherapy you do, whatever radiotherapy you do, whatever surgery you do, you can't treat a stage 4 cancer. It's literally out of question to treat a stage 4 cancer completely. There is no cure for a stage 4 cancer. Stage 1 and 2 are the best cancers to treat. They are completely curable. Anybody, I am seeing Dr. Anita Pillai, Dr. Heman, Dr. Sandhya, Dr. Veena Kolkar. A lot of people are here. They can unmute themselves and they can ask questions. If any, Dr. Vinita, Dr. Sandeep, Kanse. You can unmute and ask questions if any. Otherwise, we close this session. Dr. Ramesh Adep has joined. So if anybody has questions on this, we are free to take your questions. You can unmute and ask.